Welcome to the teaching ministry of The Anchor, Calvary Chapel, San Pedro. We invite you to join us as we journey through God's Word together, learning how to be anchored in Jesus and reflecting His grace. Here is Pastor Jerry Cesario with today's message.
So starting in verse 14, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For indeed he does not give aid to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore in all things he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for sins, for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. And all the saints said, this is the word of God. Thank you, Lord, for your word. This actually life-altering Christian walk-changing word for many of us, that you walked in our shoes. You can sympathize with us because you were tempted in every way that we were. Lord, we thank you for the cross. We thank you for what you did for us. We thank you for this morning's tithes and offerings. Continue to bless the church. Take care of the needs of the church as you faithfully do. We thank you for that and bless the cheerful givers, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Have a seat. All right. We've got plenty of time. So far in our study through the book of Hebrews, the writer is slowly, methodically, and powerfully walking us down a path of Jesus' greatness. We've seen this over the last several weeks. Jesus is greater than everything, greater than creation because he's the creator. Jesus is greater than the angels because he created them too. Last time, we saw how Jesus is greater than our sin because he came as a man, he lived a sinless life, and thus set the example for us to strive for holiness. However, because we cannot achieve 100% sinless perfection, Jesus paid the price for our redemption with his blood. And as we saw last time, he is now sanctifying us daily. He is cleansing us daily. We have been set apart. You know, you want to get into some deeper doctrines of the Christian faith. We were justified when Jesus died for our sin. That was just as if we've never sinned. Our sins have been forgiven, period. We were justified in the eyes of God, in the eyes of the Father who sits in heaven on his throne in full righteousness and holiness, a place that none of us could ever attain. And God knew that. And his Son came and died for us and paid the price for our sin, put his blood upon us to mark us as forgiven. And then that process began in each and every one of us when we came to faith in Jesus Christ. We are being sanctified. It is a daily effort, a daily struggle. It's a daily thing. And you know, if you're anything like me, you will wake up in the morning and just be thankful for another day and another breath. And, you know, a few hours into the day, you're already struggling with the peoples and the different things that come across your path. And you are challenged every day to walk in holiness, to strive for that. But it is a process of sanctification. You know, to cap the end of the doctrinal side of that, we are headed towards glorification, when we one day will rise to be with the Lord, and forever we will be with him glorified. No more sin. None of that will ever exist ever again. Praise God. Now, the author carefully inserted for us last time the work of Jesus, and I love that title of Jesus, the captain of our salvation. And he came to bring many sons to glory. He came to bring us to glory. He's going to get us to heaven, as I said. That's his work. He sanctified us. He's going to get us there. He is the captain. He is the one that is steering that ship on into eternity. You and I just have the glorious, blessed opportunity to get in that ship. In fact, the author is using nautical terms here that'll become more evident by the time we get to chapter 6. In fact, he uses some even here, just kind of alluding to, but, you know, Jesus is the anchor of our soul. That whole idea of us being with him on this journey into our glorification, to me, that's just spectacular. Now, he carefully inserted that for us. He is the captain of our salvation, bringing us to glory. And he chose to do this. And if you remember from last time, if you go back a couple of verses, he did this by suffering in our place. That's very significant to where he goes now. Because he reminds us that because of all that Jesus has done, he is not ashamed of us. He's proud to call us his brothers, his sisters. God is pleased with the work that the Son did on the cross and rising from the grave. Jesus is not ashamed of you. He is pleased to call you his own. He loves us. He cares for us. He wants us to achieve all that he has set for us in our lives and especially in glory that's ahead for us. We have jobs to do. We have a role to play in God's eternal kingdom. To me, those ideas always blow my mind. You know, you see those cartoons of people just floating around, you know, and a little fat little angels with wings and playing harps, and it's like that is not where we are headed. We are headed to a glorious destiny as the sons and daughters of Adam, that the restoration that has been done through Christ that we haven't even seen yet. The author reminds us that that's our destiny. That's where we're going. Now, again, I'm still taking all this in on a personal level, but the writer now drops another layer to it today that is just absolutely stunning. Look at verse 14. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. The author is trying to remind us here. Now remember, he's writing to Jewish Christians who are thinking, you know, they're being challenged and pressured to go back to the sacrificial system of Judaism when that is defunct. It's over. In fact, the author of Hebrews is going to tell us shortly, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. Everything has been done by Christ. But he lets us know that just as, when it says, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he's referring to the fact that you and I are human. We are born of the flesh, born of the water and the blood, as Jesus says in John chapter 3. We are human, but Jesus took on humanity. He shared in the same with us. That's just another way that the author is reminding us that Jesus, fully God, set aside his deity, his glory, his right to step on this planet and judge us for our sin. He stepped on this planet to justify us and pay for our sin, but he did that by taking on humanity. He added humanity to his deity, and he shared with us the same things that we must endure as humanity, including death. Because he knows that that is the, we're all going to die. I mean, he shared our suffering. He shared the fear of death in every way. But the case is going to be made now that he is our high priest who sympathizes with us in our suffering, in our fears, especially that fear of death. And the fear of death is a powerful thing. Would you not agree? I mean, statistics are very clear on this. 10 out of 10 people will die We are headed towards death physically. Our bodies are breaking down. I mean, our planet's breaking down. Our whole system of morality is breaking down, but that's a whole other study. But our bodies are breaking down. The older we get, the more we realize our bodies are not what they used to be. I saw a meme yesterday of an old man looking in the mirror, and he just saw the young man. It's like you feel young inside, don't you? I still feel young inside until I get up, or, you know. We had to get a new refrigerator in, and I was pulling the old one out, and it was a refrigerator, for crying out loud, just moving it off of the wall. And pulled a muscle somewhere in my hip, or I don't even know what I was like hurting for a couple of days. And then, of course, what happens? I think the Lord was making me experience, because I'm a little bit of a hypochondriac, you know, and I try to not to go to WebMD every time I get an ache, you know, and it's like sitting there thinking like, oh gosh, it's cancer or whatever. And it's like, no, I moved a refrigerator. I pulled a muscle. I hope that's all it is. Listen, who here is scared to die? I mean, hands down, very few of us are truly ready to face death head on without fear. But what the author is trying to tell us here is ever since the fall of mankind in the Garden of Eden, it's the bondage of death, or the fear of death that all men have been under, because rightfully so. You know that there is a judgment. In fact, you know, as we continue to read, there's a lot of verses you're going to find familiar that you've heard over the years, or if you've read the book of Hebrews, you know, we read in chapter 10 a certain fearful expectation of the things that are coming upon the earth, you know, and Jesus said much the same thing. But ever since the fall of man in the garden, the bondage of the fear of death has been over us. But what the author's trying to show us now is that Jesus experienced the same fear of death that you and I fear. As he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, think about it. Remember the agony that he endured there. He knew every ounce of pain that was coming. Jesus knew what he was about to endure. He knew he was about to endure the very worst of what man could do. But not only that, Jesus knew that whatever man was about to do, the Romans were going to scourge him and put him on a cross, which was the ultimate of pain, painful and shameful death in the first century. Jesus knew that whatever the Romans were going to do to him, whatever man, because they represented all humanity at that point, whatever they were going to do to him paled in comparison to what was yet to come when the Father would pour out every ounce of heaven's wrath upon him. You know, we miss that. When Jesus prayed in the garden that night, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me." And you know, he sweat blood. He was in intense agony of just anticipating what was about to happen. But he followed up those words, "Not as I will, but as you will." That's found in Matthew 26 and in the Gospel of Luke. Because Jesus Christ has put death under his feet by submitting to the Father, then going to the cross on our behalf, what the writer is telling us here is that we no longer have to fear death. Jesus went to the cross in the full fear of death. He experienced it. He knew it was coming. We miss sometimes when Jesus hung on that cross, and in that third hour or the sixth hour, when the sun went dark and the earth shook, Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was experiencing something that he, as the Son of God, had never experienced in all of his eternal existence, a separation from his Father. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit were together for eternity. Our minds can't even grasp that. They've always been. As we sang this morning, we worship the God who is, the God who was, the God who evermore will be. Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit were together for all of eternity past. And at that moment, and when Jesus hung on that cross, still fully God, but in his humanity experiencing the full pangs of death, and then the wrath of God poured out on him. And the Bible tells us that God looked away from him. Just all it took was for God to turn away from the Son, because even God could not look upon his Son with all of that sin being purged out of him, with the full wrath of heaven being poured out upon the Son. But Jesus, all he could do was cry out in that moment, my God, why have you forsaken me? But then he died. He gave up the spirit, went to the grave, and he triumphantly rose from the grave on our behalf. And that's what the author is trying to tell us. He defeated Satan at the cross. Although the devil did his very best to get Jesus to fold under the fear, and he tries to do that to us as well. According to the scriptures, the devil didn't even know exactly what was going to happen when Jesus died. God held that card very close to his vest. One of my favorite verses about the cross comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 7 through 9. When Paul is speaking, he says, "But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for our glory, the plan for our salvation, which none of the rulers of this age knew. For had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." And then he goes on with that famous verse, "But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him." Simply put, if the powers behind those who were leading the charge to kill Jesus would have known that it would result in eternal life and the freedom from the fear and bondage of death for all who would believe in Christ, they would not have done it. You know, and if you carefully read the Gospels, you will see the times when, especially during the temptation in the wilderness, the devil is trying to kind of get a bead on Jesus. He knows that he is something. He knows what's going on. It takes the devil a while to figure out that Jesus is the Son of God from heaven. I think God was holding that close to him. But then once the devil figures it out, then he's going full bore. We can't have him here on the earth. Let's kill him. And he starts to stir the people up to kill him. But he did not know that that was his own death nail. And that's what Paul reminds us. They wouldn't have done it. Friends, God loves us so much that he destroyed the works of darkness. He destroyed the fear of death, the bondage that was held over us. He destroyed that when he rose from the grave. Therefore, we must come to that point where we realize, doesn't matter what happens to us. You know, the reality is most of us are going to just grow old and have those ailments that just take us home to heaven. Some will experience more. Some will, accidents happen, things happen. But as a believer, our hope is in Christ. We know that we will be with him because the author of Hebrews has been telling us. Jesus came and died to bring many sons to glory. He's sanctifying us daily. If God chooses that it's your time to go, you're going to go. He is the one who holds life and death in his hands. But you can rest assured that you will be in glory with him, because that's his promise. to all who would believe. He understands the fear and bondage of death. That's what we're being told here. So he's overcome it as a man. And as we're going to read in a moment, tempted in all ways. He experienced everything that you and I will experience on this earth. And he prevailed over it. Therefore, we can rest assured that when it comes to the day we breathe our last here, our first breath will be in heaven with the Lord. The author continues, for indeed he does not give aid or help to angels, but he does give aid to the seed of Abraham. Therefore, in all things he had to be made like his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid or help those who are tempted. Now, the mention of Abraham was important for the Jewish Christians because it would have gotten their attention for sure. The seed of Abraham here may mean Abraham's physical descendants, and probably in one sense it does. So speaking of the Jews, but it also is referring to more than that, the spiritual seed of Abraham, the believers of every age. Remember, God told Abraham, I will send the Messiah, and through your seed, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And that is all fulfilled in Christ. That's fulfilled in this wonderful thing that we are a part of called the church. So we are all, you know, the seed of Abraham, spiritually speaking. We are the promise, the fulfilled promise of what the Messiah came to do through Abraham, through his sons, through his grandsons, through the tribe of the 12 tribes, through the tribe of Judah. So you see how that progresses all the way through. The New Testament combines both of these ideas, especially in the book of Galatians, when it comes to the person and the work of Jesus. Jesus was a Jewish Messiah who saved both Jews and Gentiles. The important point here is that Jesus did not take on the form of an angelic being, but became part of a human family and a Hebrew family at that. But now, the author takes us down a spectacular path. One that I, like I said earlier, I'm still blown away by, because I realized some things, and you know, as I was studying and just mind blowing. He tells us that because Jesus has walked in our shoes and prevailed, that he is now uniquely qualified to be our high priest, a good high priest. In fact, he'll expand upon this argument in a couple of chapters. But Jesus is now, we're told, is a merciful, faithful, and qualified high priest. Thinking back in the scriptures, there's been some high priests of Israel that were not so good, not qualified. We've got, you know, Hophni and Phinehas, who, you know, came and did, you know, strange fire. We have Eli's sons who were making the temple a brothel and taking from the people. We have Caiaphas, who was sentencing Jesus to death, essentially, and you know, turning the Romans to get his will done. It's not just a job or a ritual for Christ. Jesus knows from personal experience how it feels to be tempted, to be tried by sin, to have wickedness come at him with, and have to make a conscious decision to not sin. You know, that's kind of a misnomer sometimes. People think, well, he was God, he couldn't sin. Well, yes, because he's God, he couldn't sin. But here we're being told that he still had to submit to the Father. He still had to make a conscious decision, and he was tempted in all ways, just like us. In fact, the point is, he prevailed, so you and I can too. That's why he sent the Holy Spirit for us. You know, the author of Hebrews is going to expand on this. I'm going to give you a little spoiler here up in chapter 4. He says, seeing then that we have this great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Listen, we're going to go before the Lord and His word boldly right now. You see, the argument that the author of Hebrews is now making for the priesthood of Jesus must not be missed. Jesus is now for us, as a man and a greater high priest, He is a faithful mediator for our sins, greater than any work that any previous high priest ever did. The author refers to Jesus in verse 17 as our propitiator. Now, if you've been, in Bible studies, you've heard the word propitiation. It is a legal term. It's important that every believer understand what the word propitiation means. It shows up in the gospel, in the epistles of 1 John. Shows up here. It's a very important word, and you need to understand it is a legal term. What this means is that through His blood that was offered to the Father on our behalf, Jesus has legally satisfied the requirement of paying the price that God's holiness demands. So let's take a moment to ensure that every single one of us knows exactly what God's word says about sin and the price to be paid for sin. It's death under the wrath of God. When men and women sin, the wrath of God is stirred up against them. Romans 1, verses 18 and 19. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth and unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. And if you're familiar with Romans, Paul goes from there to show all the way that man has sinned and suppressed the truth of what God has revealed to him. And that's why God's wrath is going to be poured out upon all men and women for their ungodliness and unrighteousness. And when that happens, they make themselves enemies of God. Romans 5:10 says in that they become the enemies of God. But even in the sober context of Romans 5, we are told a much needed and glorious truth about Jesus, our Savior. I'm going to read for you Romans 5, verses 8 through 11. But God demonstrates His own love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God knew. He knew that we were lost, that we could not save ourselves. Much more then, having now been justified by His blood, we talked about that earlier, we shall be saved from the wrath through Him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of His Son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. And not only that, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. That's really a definition of the propitiation for our sin that's been given to us. Jesus satisfied God's wrath by taking it Himself and offering His blood as the final sacrifice for all sin. And in so doing, He set us free from the bondage of sin and death and from the wrath of God that should be poured out on us. And that's so important for us to understand. So do we get that? Our sin is worthy of God's wrath. But through Christ, we will never experience the wrath of God if we are truly born again and in Him, because He already did it for us. So that brings us back to where we are here in Hebrews. To accomplish this, Jesus did what no other high priest ever did or could do. He offered himself as a sinless sacrifice. He willingly died in our place. And what we're being told now in relation to the humanity of Jesus is that his experiences in his humanity make him more merciful than we could ever be. For example, suppose we're driving down the street and we witness an accident and we see a victim lying on the road in great pain and distress. We may feel for them. We may stop and look for a moment, call 911, but mostly we do nothing and we drive by. Why? Because we're unmerciful. By nature, we are unmerciful. Let someone else take care of it. But then nobody does. It's kind of that whole idea that everybody has. I mean, I'm sure you go to work tomorrow, right? Don't you have those people at your work that just, you know, when there's work to be done, they're like, someone else will take care of it. To be merciful, one must act to alleviate someone else's pain and suffering. You can't just feel for them. God didn't sit in heaven and feel for us and say, well, sorry, I gave you a perfect planet. You broke it. You know, I feel for you. No, he did something about it. My friends, that's what Jesus does. He repeatedly modeled this for us in the Gospels as he healed and fed and extended compassion to others. We need to understand that when the Bible tells us Jesus had compassion for the people, he was moved in his spirit when he saw the people, when he saw the lame man, you know, at the gates of Jerusalem, when he saw the blind man crying out, Son of David, help me. Jesus didn't go, yeah, you know, Mary Poppins on him or something. He was like, he understood that man cannot do anything himself because we are so broken. Sin has marred our entire image of God in us and what we're supposed to be. We have, you know, even as believers, when we are filled with the Spirit of God, we get glimpses of that. We have days where we experience mercy and compassion. Have you ever done that before? Like you've done something and then you realize later, like, wow, that was really the Holy Spirit. That's not really how I am. Yet I felt such a compassion to do that. That's because the Spirit of God is moving in you to show you who you should be. And what the potential of who you are, that you've been set free from that unmercifulness. And that's why the scriptures tells us you've been had great mercy extended to you as Christians. We are to be those who extend mercy to others because it's been done for us. But here's the thing. Even now, as Jesus sits in heaven praying for us. We're told that he's interceding for us, right? 2 Timothy 2, he is our mediator, one mediator between God and men. And as the man, Christ Jesus, he intercedes for us. He prays for us. But even now, as he sits there praying for us, he does so with the same compassion and mercy that he did when he was on the earth. And because he is still a man, don't miss this today. Because he is still a man who was tempted in all ways as we are, he has personal emotion and compassion for us because he's been there. Jesus actually feels our pain of human existence. His compassion, his mercy is not just heavenly, it's real. And it's from the very depths of his heart as he acts for us, as he prays for us, as he sends his Holy Spirit to lift us and comfort us and help us in our time of need. That's what the author is trying to remind us. He doesn't give aid to the angels. They don't need any help. They help him. They go and do his bidding. He doesn't give help to the angels. He gives help to us because we're the ones in need of it. And he's praying for us. And this is where I just, my mind was just blown this week as I thought about this. You know, and I think I've known this on some level, and I think most of us do. But to really think about what the author of Hebrews is trying to lay out for us, Jesus prays for us when we sin, and when rightfully so, the wrath of God should be poured out on us, and we know that he blocks that because of his righteousness has been applied to us. But when he prays for us as we sin or fail or fall, he then reminds the Father that he endured the same temptation and that he prevailed. And now when he prays for us, he says, Lord, you know, Father, give them an extra portion of your spirit today so that they can recognize that they need you more and more. He's been there. I mean, I don't know how to explain it any deeper than that. I used to really just think, you know, yeah, Jesus is praying for me. Thank you, Lord, for praying for me. You know, it's awesome. But now I realize he prays for me because he's gone through the same temptations that I have. And that's where the focus of his prayers. You ever had those times when you're praying and your prayers are really focused because you can identify with something or someone that you're praying for and you can identify with that? That's Jesus 24/7. There's nothing that happens in your life that Jesus has not experienced. So when he prays for you, he is praying for you from experience. He feels every ounce of the temptation, the pain, the sorrow, the struggle that you are. That's so important for us to understand. It's so important for us to live out from the depths of our souls. So what we need to get from this is really powerful. First, Jesus is absolutely faithful as our sin bearer, our propitiator. He did everything required to save us. Hands down, there is no other name under heaven by which we can be saved other than the name of Jesus Christ. He did the work, and he legally paid the price. But second, Jesus faithfully represents us to the Father as our mediator. He ensures that his blood is applied to our sins forever, every time. No questions asked, because we have put ourselves under Christ. And he does all this because he faithfully prays for us. He sympathizes for us. He has understanding and compassion and tender mercy always extended to us because he's always praying for us. The author of Hebrews is progressively showing us how Jesus is our priestly mediator, propitiator, and now our helper. Look at verse 18 again. In light of everything else, he says, for in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid or help those who are tempted. Now, again, let's not forget the original audience that the letter was for. As a church of Jewish Christians who were under siege to go back to the law and the sacrifices of the temple, they were experiencing regular daily temptations of sin just like us. Don't forget that. Sometimes we can compartmentalize them like, well, they're just a bunch of Christians going, well, I think we just need to go give sacrifices. It was way deeper than that. They were struggling with sin and temptations. And somewhere along the line, someone had told them that Jesus wasn't enough for them. I don't know everybody's church background, but there are churches today that even tell people that in some way or another. You know, you need to repent every Sunday, walk down the aisle and give your heart to Christ. You know, you get saved on Sunday, you're backslidden and going to hell by Sunday night or Monday morning. That's the same temptation. And then when you struggle and when you sin, there's always somebody there to tell you how you need to repent and get back. You know, you got to get saved again. You know, the scriptures do not teach that. Once for all, Jesus died for all sin. His sacrifice has been placed before the Father, accepted, and now you are the benefit. Why? because it's secure and set for all of eternity. You are sealed until the day of redemption. But not only that, Jesus is praying for you because he's experienced every temptation that you have. So that prayer and that compassion. And these early Christians were experiencing that. They were also being tempted to give up, find another way to deal with their sins. But here they're encouraged to keep going because Jesus understands. They may be facing temptations, but Jesus faced far greater than anyone ever did. And thus, he not only understood what they were facing, he empathized, he sympathized, he forgave them, he interceded for them, and he empowered them to persevere. Christian, it comes down to this. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was made like us in every way so that he could be to us everything we need. We need someone to compassionately pray for us in our weakness. Jesus is full of compassion and mercy, so he can do that. We need someone that's experienced us because he walked in this earth in humanity. And really, with that, the first major section of the book of Hebrews has now been covered. Jesus is greater than all of our weaknesses is the summation now. Greater than creation, greater than the angels. He's, you know, the author, next chapter, he's greater than Moses. He's going to keep walking down this path and really drill down on how he's greater than any of the high priests. He kind of whet our appetite for that right now. But Jesus is greater, really, than our weaknesses. You can rely on him. You can rely on his prayers for you and on his the power of the Holy Spirit to do the same that he did for the first century Christians, just like he does for us today. He empathizes, he sympathizes, he has forgiven us, he intercedes for us, and then he sends his Spirit to empower us so that we can persevere. As a Son of God, Jesus extends his hand of deity over our sins. As the Son of Man, he places his hand over our humanity. And there the two meet. And as the writer of Psalms says, justice and mercy kissed. They meet. Jesus stands in the unique position over all of space, time, and eternity, as the one person who can completely satisfy God's holy demands and also satisfy man's needs in pursuit of godliness. To me, that's just mind-blowing. I hope you get that. Meditate on that. Think about it. Go back and read it. Maybe I missed something. I think I repeated myself plenty of times. So, listen, we may face hardship. We may face even discipline from the Lord. We saw that in our study in Proverbs this week. The Lord chastens those whom he loves. But we will never face the wrath of God because we are forever under the compassionate, faithful, and merciful love of Jesus, who not only walked in our place, now prays in our place, and in effect walks with us still. I haven't ended with a hymn for a while. 1912, C. Austin Miles' hymn, I Come to the Garden Alone. I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. And the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me and he talks with me. And he tells me that I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. That's a great summation of what we've read today. He walks with us because he's already walked ahead of us. Father, thank you for your great word to us today. Thank you that you are now sitting in heaven praying for us, interceding for us. The legal work has been done. Now the work of prayer is constantly done until we get to heaven. You're committed to seeing us through. We just give you glory. We give you praise. We give you all the honor today for who you are, what you've done. Lord, put this word deep down into our hearts. Help it change us. Give us a whole new perspective of what you're doing for us and how you see us. We're no different than any of the people that you encountered on this earth when you walked here physically. We're no different. You still love us just as much because you have experienced everything that we have and will. God, you're good. Thank you, Lord. Send us out to shine a light in this community. We just thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name.